Hello. Hello. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the AA. My name is Ana Araujo. I'm a tutor here, and together with Catalina Mejia Moreno, who's there, I curated the exhibition Lina and Gio, The Last Humanists, which is in the gallery here, and also the exhibition The Work of Lina Bo Bardi, which is in the front members room upstairs in the first floor. So before I start introducing today's speakers, I would like to thank our sponsors. So first, the AA for hosting and supporting the exhibition as well as this event. And also the Embassy of Brazil in London, who is very kindly supporting us. I would also like to thank the exhibition and events team at the AA, in particular Vanessa Norwood, Lee Regan, Alex Booker, Tim Eve, Mel Thomas, and Nick Wayne. And also, of course, thanks to the speakers who traveled a long way to be here with us tonight. I would also like to mention that the AA will soon be launching a publication of Lina Bo Bardi's writings as part of their series AA Words. So this book should be out within the next month or so, and it will be the first time that many of the texts are translated to English. So please watch out for that. We also have a book launch very soon. So this evening we have here Marco Romanelli from Milan, Italy. Isa Crispum Ferraz, Marcelo Ferraz, and Giancarlo Latorraca, all three from São Paulo, Brazil. And I will make very short introductions of the speakers and their talks. And if you want to know more information about them, there are full biographies in the brochure that goes with the exhibition next door. So our first speaker will be Marco Romanelli. He's an architect and designer, and he runs the practice Laudani and Romanelli, based in Rome and in Milan. Marco Romanelli was the curator of the exhibition Gio Ponti, A World, which took place in the Design Museum in London in 2002. Today, Marco will be talking us through the many facets of Gio Ponti, who was an architect, a writer, a curator, an artist, a set designer. And he will tell us why it is important to revisit the work of Gio Ponti today. After Marco Romanelli, we will have Isa Crispum Ferraz, who is not an architect, as she likes to say. Isa writes scripts for films and documentaries, and she also works with museum collections. Isa was both a collaborator and a friend of Lina Bo Bardi, and her paper today, and you should have copies of her paper, will address Lina's political and ideological positions, and Isa will also give us a glance of Lina's personal character. Then our third speaker is Giancarlo Latorraca, who is the technical director of the Museu da Casa Brasileira in São Paulo. It's the Museum of the Brazilian House. He graduated in architecture in the early 90s, and he worked as an intern in Lina Bo Bardi's office, making models, as he told me. Giancarlo also collaborated with the office Brasil Arquitetura and with the architect Paulo Mendes da Rocha. And today, Giancarlo will be reading a paper, also available for you, about Lina Bo Bardi's role as an architect, a furniture designer, and mainly as a woman who had a very unique understanding of Brazilian material culture. Then our last speaker, but not least, is Marcelo Ferraz, who was Lina Bo Bardi's main collaborator. Marcelo worked with Lina for 15 years, and he was also a close friend of her. And today he will tell us about his experience working with Lina and about his understanding of her architecture. So the presentations will be fairly short, around 20 minutes, and then after the presentations we will have a discussion. So I will hand over to Marco. Thank you very much.
Good evening, and I'm Marco Romanelli, and I would like to do three different parts in my little speech, and I try to go very fast because the title of my work on Gio Ponti is Gio Ponti, a word, in the sense that really Gio Ponti is a word, and so it's not so easy to speak about Gio Ponti in half an hour. We can stay there perhaps 1 month, not half an hour. And so I will try to be very, very short. But in the beginning, I would like to read some little sentences. You know that the most important book written by Gio Ponti, I must say Gio Ponti has written perhaps 50, 60 books, but the most important is Amate l'architettura, that I prefer translate Do Love Architecture, while the official translation of 61 is In Praise of Architecture. That is not strong enough. And in this book, Ponti invent a new kind of language that is not at all an academic language. And so it was very strange in the Italian situation. Love Architecture. Love modern architecture for its young architects. The future lies in their hands. Love good modern architects. Root for one or the other. Associate your name with their works, and your name will endure with them. Love them without indulgence. Give them work. Architecture is a crystal. This is a very important point. Architecture is a crystal. Pure architecture is a crystal. When it is pure, is as pure as a crystal. Magic, closed, exclusive, autonomous, uncontaminated, uncorrupted, absolute. Definitive, like a crystal. Architecture stands, finished and firm, abstract, marvelous and rare, like a crystal, among trees and clouds and lights and waters that keep moving, and time that keeps passing. Architecture is a crystal. Like a crystal, it is something pure, but fixed to the ground, a little deep in it, but rising from it. It has roots. Architecture has roots. Past, present, future. The past doesn't exist. Everything is simultaneous in our life and culture. Simultaneous and coexistent in our culture are Bach and Stravinsky, Raphael and Picasso, Fidia and Moore. Sappho doesn't belong to a past we didn't share. She belongs to the present of our knowledge. She will belong to the future. The architect, the artist, must imagine for each window a person at a sill, for each door a person passing through, for each stair a person going up or down, for each terrace somebody resting, for each room somebody living within. The architect of today, the college architect, must learn from all the artisans, from the marble cutter, from the carpenter, the plasterer, the blacksmith, from all workers and craftsmen. He must learn things made by hand, nothing if not first in our hands. Raw materials, not cement, not wood, not stone, not iron, not steel, not aluminium, not ceramics, not glass, is the most durable raw material. The most durable raw material in building is art. Art is always the raw material. And now some sentences written by me about Ponti. And actually I must say that all kind of commemoration is something that is not about Gio Ponti. I think that we must come back to Ponti not for a sort of nostalgia for the past, but to understand something of our future, and something that is very important to go out of the impasse of contemporary architecture and design. So The main lesson of Gio Ponti lies for me in his completeness, in his being a total architect. Accomplished in urban planning, in architecture, in product design, Ponti was also an interior decorator, a painter, a poet, a set designer, and a writer. And he never placed these different roles, these different fields of action, in any sort of hierarchy. He didn't consider any one of them more worthy than any other. They were all, for him, operation of design. He worked on mass-produced objects and limited editions for ultra-rich clients and public housing. The method, and I must say method is not a Pontian word, the method was always the same. The intensity, this is a Pontian word, was always the same. And what's more, we can always find the same foundation and the same inspiration in the exceptional project for the elite, such as the porcelain pieces from Richard Ginori or the Villa Planchard in Caracas, as in the more populist projects for everyone, mass-produced ceramics, hospitals, churches. But total architect has another kind of meaning for Gio Ponti. This is very important. A Ponti building was faced with materials designed by Ponti. They were fitted with doors and windows by Ponti. They were furnished with sofa and lamps and curtains and bathroom tapes conceived by Ponti. A total work done by Ponti. So the work of a total architect is a total work. And there is no change of scale and value in this work. There is no decrease in quality or interest. This is very different from today, I must say. The total work means for Ponti a total quality. And this was the way, a total quality, that Ponti decided to use to communicate with people, with common people. Because the idea of Ponti, that naturally was a very sophisticated artist and intellectual, was that it was possible that everyone can be able to read architecture and to understand architecture. His architecture and the architecture of the friends of Ponti all around the world. Because we must say that one big question, big problem, big interest about Ponti is that he was considering the promotion of architecture of the others quite similar to direct design. So this is a very important role in the world. Ponti was in some sense immune to professional jealousy, and so he tried to promote the work of other creative minds, and in this way, from 1928 to 1979, so the period he was editor-in-chief of Domus, in the page of his extraordinary magazine, there was a sort of a herald around the world announcing the best architecture and the best design. Another important lesson we can learn from Gio Ponti lies for me in his continual evolution. This is another kind of thing that doesn't happen so often now. Ponti never takes refuge in a style, never becomes a slave to his own success. Every 10 years or so, his architecture and design would change, a highly unusual practice among architects. The result was that he continued to surprise everyone, although this often meant disorienting the critics and above all disappointing big clients who thought they were paying for the Ponti of the previous decade. So this was something that was not so accepted. But there is for me a clearly clear evolutionary process in Ponti's work. Where does he want to take us? Toward lightning, toward weightlessness.
We can find numerous estimation of this from the very beginning of Ponti's career, but we are especially interested here in the 1950s onward, when he developed the concept of architecture is a diamond, architecture is a crystal. It's important to clarify that the concept of architecture is a crystal is not by any means an abstraction. Ponti is not dispensing rhetorical figure here. For Ponti, architecture really is a diamond. It's built from inside out, following the generative lines of pathways and sidelines of the inhabitants. This is a difficult point, but if you have the occasion to have a look of a plan of Gio Ponti, you are going to see that it doesn't exist only the lines we know very well of walls, of doors, of the construction, but it exists other lines that go through the plan, in the center of the plan, and then perhaps make a relationship between a sofa and a window, a chimney and a door. Or there is the way the person, the inhabitants, was entering in this kind of house. These lines are going to generate a diamond. So the exterior of the architecture of Ponti was generated by the interior, by those drawings in interior that gives the shape of a diamond. And another very important aspect is light. Light is a very important actor in the process of Ponti to lightness. The light that comes out from the cuts of the hands of the side of the Pirelli Tower, we are going to see it, the light that filters from the roof of Villa Planchard. It's easier to play with light during the night, but the Ponti building was playing with light also during the day, because he doesn't use in the 50s the intonaco, but he was completely covering his buildings with tiles, ceramic tiles that were diamond shaped, blue, silver, green, tiles that never allows light to rest. But this was not enough for Ponti, and this kind of battle of war for lightness was not ended. And so it was not enough diamond-shaped tiles. He wanted the fog and the sky can pass through the facade. And so in 1964, at the age of 73, he designed his windows into the void for the Church of San Francesco in Milano. He called them the windows who capture the sky. And the idea, the purpose, was to look beyond. Lastly, in 1970, now Ponti was 80 years old, he imagined a church, specifically the Cathedral of Taranto, beneath the sun of southern Italy. It is the last ode to weightlessness. The facade is an origami, a double perforated screen reflected in the water. The window on the beyond had finally found its apotheosis here in this impossible space of this facade. When in the day of the opening of the church, a functionalistic critic, we were in 1970, was asking Ponti, but what does which is the use of this kind of facade? There is no use, no function. And Ponti, very quietly, was answering, where else would the angels sit? I think it's the best answer to a functionalistic critic. And now, how many minutes I have more? Anna, 10 minutes? 5 minutes? 2 minutes? 100 pictures in 2 minutes. We are going to have a rush. Allora, This is very important because Gio Ponti was born on 18 November 1891, so 2 centuries ago. After a classical schooling, he goes to the Faculty of Architecture, but he can't graduate before the end of the First World War. During the First World War, he served as an officer on the front line, and he takes some decoration, some watercolors of his friends, and a permanent memory of the Palladian architecture. He was sleeping during the night in the Palladian villas in Veneto. And he was married in 1921 with Giulia Vimercati. They had 4 children, Lisa, Giovanna, Giulio, and Letizia. This is a Campigli painting of the Ponti family. In 1923, just coming back from the war, he was becoming the art director of the Richard Ginori fabric. This is very important because there was 2 points. One was at Doccia in Tuscany, where they prepare the great pieces for museum and collection. But the most important thing is that this experience was put in another factory, in another point of production, that was San Cristoforo near Milano, where Ponti has designed families of pieces in mass production for everyday use. So there is always a sort of passage from the high level and from the everyday use. Naturally, there was a sort of ironic neoclassicism, and again, there was angels playing golf in his ceramics. And the first architecture he has done was in 1925, the house in Via Randaccio, that is as a concave facade, and the obelisk. You will see the obelisk all through the life of Ponti. In 1928, there is the beginning of Domus, naturally, and Lisa Ponti says that Domus is like Gio Ponti, always contained everything. For Ponti, Domus was a living journal, full of ideas for giving away. After the war, Domus immediately turned to America, Eames, Fuller, Saarinen, Calder, and come back to France, Le Corbusier, and to Finland, Virkala. Then Ponti went to Brazil, where he met Niemeyer and Lina, to Mexico, where he met Barragán, and all this appeared in Domus, and Domus itself, in the 50s, was a 50s object. In 1936, he was building this very, very important architecture. On the left, you see the building of 36. On the right, the second building, the second Montecatini building, 51. And this is very important. You see that there is a H-shaped plan on the left, and there is a specific reason. In the center, there was the place for manager, and on the two sides, the place for the employees. And all the architecture is done with the module of the desk of the employee. So if you look at the windows, lot of windows, each window has the space for 2 desks. So this was the reason of the facade. And as you can see, the windows are set flush to the surface, and so there is the impression of no thickness. And this is very important also for the finishing of the facade. This is in marble, with a marble called Tempesta. And Ponti was saying, I have created a marble because I've cut the block, cross-cut, and so there is a new kind of marble. But the theme, this is the manager part, this is the employee part, and this is the window. But the theme of the window is very important through all the work of Gio Ponti. Here you can see an embroidered silk, 1933. The name is Morosi alla finestra, lovers at the window. And if you think that in 1960, in Nemase Villa, in Tehran, with Fausto Melotti, there is the same thing, lovers at the windows that are in the sculpture of Melotti in this beautiful patio. And then there is another kind of question that is very important for me, that is this kind of coming back to the work through time. Let's say this chair was designed for the first time in 36, and then it was redesigned in 79 with a complete different technique, because there is a pantograph, plywood naturally, but you see that there is the same idea. Oh, another kind of question, very important, is the Mediterranean law. Ponti was saying in 1940, when he was coming away from the official charges in architecture to go to more private clients because of the war, he was trying to find a Mediterranean law to build under the sun. And so with Rudowski, we have this kind of white building with terraces, and the terraces have masonry work, furniture, and tiling. In the same period, 1940, he was working like painter in the Scalone del Bo in Padova, where we can see the lesson of Campigli, actually. And here Lisa, very young, the daughter, was working with him. Then we go very, very... this is a sort of very strange and difficult work on furniture, because the surface is done in copper by De Poli, with again all kind of images by Ponti. And actually then all typologies were done by Ponti. Here the La Pavoni coffee machine, 48, where Ponti was saying, I want to achieve the perfect simplicity of certain wind instruments. And then naturally fabric, this is the summer fabric, or here you can say the ballet La Scala, or in the 70, this is a written fabric. And then the work with Fornasetti, Ponti has no problem with decoration. He was very, very sure of himself. So he was going through a decorative experience without problems. And here the chair is all inhabited by butterflies. And here's the furniture done for the Triennale, 1951. And this is another piece that I like very much, and I think is very, very important, that is called Painting on a Support, perhaps. This is interesting because Ponti was saying, why I have to put a painting on the wall? That is much easier to have it near me, and I can talk with the painting all the time. And again, naturally, all the great period of 50s with the design for Cassina, or with this piece that is not known at all, that is called 8 pieces, because you can see that the armchair is done only with 8 pieces. And then Ponti was the first one working for 2 companies in New York, Altamira and Singer, designing a complete collection of furniture. And this is a magazine rack, for example. Oh, this is the period, I must say, it's very important, of the furnished window. On the left, you can see a furnished window, and on the right, this kind of panel was the back of a desk, let's say. Ponti was calling those kind of furniture organized walls. This is very important because there Ponti put together more function in a poetic way. And there was also an invention of names, self-illuminated furniture, furnished window, organized wall. Ponti invented names to describe new typologies. And those furniture were really anti-bourgeois, because they was trying to eliminate the traditional reference in furnishing. you can see a self-illuminating panel. This is 1952, the car touring that was done by Alfa Romeo, but was not put in production. But in the 70s, you can see in Alfa Romeo and in Saab exactly the same model of car, 20 years after. And then naturally, also for sanitary fixture that was transformed into sculpture by Ponti, or with plates and clothes, and with the same design for plates and cloth, and so there was a sort of integrated graphic design. And then here, Ponti, 54. Let's imagine that after 54, Ponti was not a young man, you can see. So you must always imagine that he was born 2 centuries ago. So we must pay attention to the dates, because it's very important for me. Villa Planchard in Caracas, here Ponti was meeting the ideal client. The villa is the real occasion of a total design, outside, inside, in the garden. The external walls appears to be detached one to the other as well from the roof and from the ground. This is evident at night because the artificial light come out from those cuts. Ponti was calling this villa again a butterfly on the hill. And inside, you can imagine this is the design of the roof, and with windows looking inside the living room, and with the table that have the same design than the roof. Then there is another history. This is the history of Superleggera. You have seen here in the exhibition 2 Superleggera, but perhaps we must notice that the design of Superleggera began in 1949. So 1949-1957, in this period Ponti has this kind of obsession of designing a chair with a sort of bent back and pointed leg, and it comes to Superleggera step by step in 52 the Leggera, and then in 57 the Superleggera, that has this very important point that you can take it up with one finger. But the structure was very strong, a triangular structure. And this is a beautiful drawn letter done by pen and finger dripped in the ink. That is, the name is Seated Cloud. So on the Superleggera, only a cloud can be seated. The same problem is with this chest of drawer. You can see that the body is in clear wood, but the projecting elements are the handles. So you don't see the weight and the volume of the chest of drawer because you are looking to the handles. Letters. Here I would like to read, and then I go really fast, a little sentences by Lisa Ponti. There were 60 hours in Gio Ponti's day, 60 hours. The first 10 hours, between 5 and 6 in the morning, he would draw and write 30 letters. Letters to his friends saying hello and thanks, and letters to his collaborators, telling them that the project has changed during the night and that 8 or 9 variants were requiring urgent attention. Ponti sent throughout his life hundreds and hundreds of drawn letters to his friends with a message of thanks or good wishes or making a request or exclaiming hurrah. First, they were finally penned in ink, but in his later years, as his eyesight began to fail, there was this very large felt pen. The same process with those figures that were cutted in copper, and Ponti said they were drawn with the scissor, or with cutlery, or with handle, or with skyscraper. It's always the same. And here there is the famous plan of the Pirelli Tower. Here is very important the dimension. You can imagine that the Pirelli Tower is high 127 meters. We are in 56. But he's deep 18 meters. And is wide 70 meters. So this is what Ponti was calling a finite form. He doesn't stand on a basement, but it emerges pure. The resistance to wind was a great problem, naturally, and it was solved with, here you can see, the points that are structural, and the center that is structural again. And we must say that common Milanese people, who knows nothing of Ponti, loves the Pirelli Tower and call it Pirellone, the big Pirelli, Pirellone, and consider it the civil symbol of their town. Here you see the light during the night. And this is the book, Do Love Architecture. And again, the problem of light and shadow in a lamp of 1960. The Church of San Francesco, 1964. As I was saying before, the facade is cutted because the sky and the rain and the fog can pass through the facade. And this is another church, the Church of San Carlo. This is a sort of summary of the Ponti invention, because you can see that there is a plan that is a sort of hexagon. The windows that are diamonds, and this kind of strange situation, because you have the altar that is coming on, and on the back side, on the other side, also the place for the public, let's say, is like in the theater. You are going to stay here, the priest, here, the public. And you enter on the center. Another problem of Ponti, 67, is the problem of rhythm and of building in a city. And he was writing, for smoggy cities with narrow street, shiny facade illuminated by the sky. And then he was also saying, and rain will wash them. That is very important. And naturally we go on through plates. And when he was 80, he was designing a last collection of furniture in a house that he has a house with moving walls and with furniture in colors and on castors, because it can move all around. And was very light. A man of 80 years old was designing those things. And also, this is another kind of, I think this is the piece with Superleggera, the greatest piece of design of Ponti, is called An Armchair of Little Seat. And Ponti was saying, in order to sit comfortably, you need little seat and a lot of back. And then you see Ponti working at, at the Cathedral of Taranto. And the Cathedral of Taranto is a not known architecture. If you are looking to a book of history of Italian architecture, you don't find the Cathedral of Taranto. It's something so in the future, and you can see that there is a sail instead of towers and dome. The sail is a sort of landmark, and it reflects itself in a basin of water. And so there are two facades, the first one to enter in the church, and the second one, Ponti was saying, for the air. And then the last work of Ponti is the Denver Art Museum, 1971. This building was immediately called by the people of Denver the fortress or the castle, because you see that there is only narrow windows. And Ponti was very happy about this fortress or castle name. He was saying, art is a treasure, and so those jealous walls will defend it. And then Ponti was very old, alone in the family house in Viadezza, practically blind, but he was still drawing angels on plexiglass, because he put the plexiglass on the windows and the light coming through allowed him to see the angel that he was designing. And naturally, for me, those are the same angels that were sitting on the Taranto facade. Thank you.
Good evening. I would like to apologize for my bad, very bad English. And I would like to thank for this invitation by the AA and for the support of Brazilian Embassy. So I'm not an architect. I studied social sciences and philosophy, and I work in the production of documentaries and museum exhibitions. The contribution I can bring to this discussion is of someone who lived and worked with Lina Bo Bardi, for many years. I collaborated with Lina in the book Tempos de Grossura, which translates as Times of Redness. And later, in 1989-90, I helped her catalog the many texts that she wrote throughout her life. After her death in 93, I wrote the script for a documentary about her work that you see in the gallery, edited the texts of many books published about her, and organized an exhibition in Mexico about her research on Brazilian popular art. As a young woman, I had the privilege to participate in many of the social events took place in the Glass House, as I am married with the architect Marcelo Ferraz, who collaborated with Lina for 15 years. During this period, we were very connected to her. We were often invited to the Saturday and Sunday lunches at the Glass House, where the Bardi couple received many interesting guests, culturally minded people, Brazilians and foreigners of many parts of the world. Marcelo and I became close friends of Lina, who also became the godmother of our eldest son. In 1980, Lina invited me to help her in the organization of a book through which she intended to disseminate her reflections and research on the popular culture of the Brazilian Northeast. Lina had lived in Bahia, in Salvador da Bahia, in the beginning of the 60s. And in that period, she opened and directed the Museum of Modern Art of Bahia. In the 5 years that she ran the museum, Lina had a major influence on that culture. Around her work, seminal names of Brazilian culture gathered together. Avant-garde composers like Kohlreuter and Smetak, people from the performative arts, such as the director Martin Gonçalves, the dancer Janka Hutzka, and the young filmmaker Glauber Rocha, lived at this moment a unique experience in the cultural history of Brazil. In this vibrant environment, flourished a great generation of musicians, poets, filmmakers, actors, actresses, and fine artists, Caetano Veloso, Gilberto Gil, and Maria Bethânia, to mention but a few of them, who had a major role in the development of Brazilian popular culture in the following years. While in Bahia, Lina dived into the rich world of Brazilian material culture in an area known for its explosive popular creativity, but also for its poverty. With an approach that was, at the same time, scholarly and liberated, sophisticated and open, cultivated and free of prejudices, Lina could see in a world commonly regarded as dry and unproductive, a vigorous vitality that had been so far ignored by Brazilian high culture. This all happened in an agitated social and political context, the 60s, a moment where everything seemed possible. I will show a little pedaço.
A little video.
Matéria-prima, o lixo. Lâmpadas queimadas, recorte de tecidos, latas de lubrificante, caixas velhas e jornais. Cada objeto risca o limite do nada da matéria. Formas cheias de eletricidade vital. Esta exposição é uma acusação.
Nos confins do sertão, Deus criou o mundo e o diabo o arame farpado. Não vale mais a sentença clássica. O sertanejo não é, antes de tudo, um forte. É, antes de tudo, um servo da mais primitiva condição. Os remanescentes da vida, pistoleiros e prostitutas emigrando, camponeses arando nada, tantos meninos morrendo por hora. E a casa grande e a senzala devidamente celebrados. Em setembro de 1959, Lina, em colaboração com Martim Gonçalves, diretor da Escola de Teatro da Universidade da Bahia, monta em São Paulo a Exposição Bahia. Foi a primeira apresentação no sul do país dos problemas culturais do Nordeste. Nada de folclore. A exposição era mais de antropologia cultural do que de arte, e com sua violência popular, inaugurava uma maneira revolucionária de expor.
Montar uma Exposição Bahia, que foi inaugurada por Juscelino Kubitschek. Era uma coisa fantástica. Uma documentação toda de Pierre Verger, Gautreau. Eu fiz o chão todo de folhas secas.
Esta exposição procura apresentar uma civilização pensada em todos os detalhes, estudada tecnicamente. É um convite para os jovens considerarem o problema da simplificação, não da indigência, no mundo de hoje. Caminho necessário para encontrar dentro do humanismo técnico uma poética.
Depois dessa exposição...
Podemos desligar? Acender. Lina was brilliant and irreverent, and she had luggage. Without affiliating to any particular school of thought, but drinking from many different sources, this Italian-Brazilian was part of a generation of artists and intellectuals that believed it was possible to build a wide social and cultural project to completely transform the existing social structures. She fought against misery and against mediocrity, or against what she called moral mediocrity. Leaving behind a ruined Europe, Lina found in Brazil a fertile ground for her creations. As the philosopher Eduardo Subirats wrote, the European avant-garde expressed an existential anxiety in relation to a past which made it wrong, but which worked also as its anchor point. On the other hand, the Brazilian anthropophagists found in its American history, in the indigenous languages and in the popular artistic expressions, a creative principle that enabled them to create new things in formal terms as well as in terms of a social utopia. Beyond the demand for an emancipated culture, anthropophagy pointed to a civilizing project that was originally American. It was a local avant-garde, yes, but a globalized and a civilized one. Under this umbrella, one would search for inspiration in the free forms, in new themes, and new languages. Lina belonged to this tradition. Eager to know and to value the most profound and hybrid roots of our culture, she dived deep into this exuberant and contradictory reality. Sorry about my English. In this process, she discovered the richness of what she called the pre-craft of the Brazilian Northeast, very rough in its appearance. She proposed to document it and to study the deep structure of its original creative potential, the simplicity of its forms, its rigor, its economy of means. As she used to say, the objects she found in the Northeast are an example of a direct simplification of forms, full of vital electricity. These objects hold a strong resonance with Brazilian soul, and this is important in the highly artificial world of today. The work of Lina, whether architecture, exhibitions, or writings, is in a way a manifesto for the possibility of creating form which is free and decolonized and also liberated from inferiority complexes with regards to trendy currents of thought. Lina believed that no model could explain Brazil, a country full of potential, promising and problematic. For this reason, she would say, it's important to know the country in order to be able to reinvent it. The documentation of this pre-craft that she carefully studied and researched had at the same time a tone of accusation. It was a reaction against the poor living conditions of a significant portion of the Brazilian population at that time. Lina held a strong anthropological stance, a sensibility turned towards humankind. She was a radically committed woman living in a moment that promised to bring great transformations to the Brazilian society. It was from this seed that flourished in Brazil manifestation as diverse as the Cinema Novo, Concrete Poetry, Bossa Nova, Tropicália, a radically new theater, an aesthetic production committed to contemporary reality. A series of new paths opened as well in architecture and in the fine arts. With the coup of 64 and the military dictatorship that was implemented in Brazil, all this world of renovation was violently dismantled. the repercussions in the universities and in the intellectual and artistic life of the country were brutal, with the imprisonment, death, and exile of many of the best characters of this generation. Lina was then the director of the Museum of Modern Art of Bahia, culturally and politically engaged in the movements for transforming the country. As a consequence of the coup, she was forced to leave Bahia and to move back to São Paulo. Towards the end of the 60s, beginning of the 70s, with the worsening of military dictatorship, Lina was persecuted for its support of radical left-wing movements and had to leave the country and stay in Italy. She came back to Brazil in 1972. The Brazilian Academia, in particular the one of São Paulo, has always doubted Lina's independent way of thinking. She was always at the margins of groups and corporations. The new generations formed after the dictatorship, victims of a controlled university and of a censored press, only recently got to know the density and complexity of her oeuvre, so diversified. In 1980, after almost a year of intense work organizing the material for the publication of the book Times of Rudeness, Lina gave up. She told me, "This will fall into a void. No one will understand it." At that moment, the craft from the Northwest was trendy. That desperate effort to promote culture that Lina saw in the objects made with the waste of the civilization of consumerism turned into trivial souvenirs. She would say recently, Brazil has lost its track. Although we understood what she said, we still tried to persuade her to publish the book, but she wouldn't. Only in 1994, after her death, the Bardi Institute launched Tempos de Grossura. This is a disturbing book, which deals with issues that remain up to this moment unresolved, such as the waste in consumerist society, the contempt of the press and of high culture towards meaningful human actions, which remain as a consequence invisible or regarded as minor. For example, the uneven distribution of land in Brazil, addressed in the book as a backdrop of Lina's research on pre-craft. In 1989, Lina invited me to work with her again to organize her personal archives. This time, there were countless drawers and shelves filled with notes, drawings, photographs, letters, diaries, a wealth of gems scattered here and there amongst books, journals, magazines, all disorderly and chaotic. Lina had the habit of writing about everything, loose sentences handwritten in used envelopes, packages, checkbooks, lots of letters and telegrams received from friends, colleagues, some correspondence with her husband Pietro, her intimate diaries. For months in the glass house, I tried to find a method, a logic that would help me find a way to organize all these things. Lina was always around, coming and going, clarifying some points, dates, giving some clues. Maybe age had made her aware of the richness of this material and of the urgency of ordering it. I don't know. All I know is that the task wasn't easy. It was a year of intense work. However, with Lina's illness, we unfortunately had to interrupt this process. Lina passed away in 1902, and the Bardi Institute finally decided to take charge of the dissemination of her work. Till then, she had never allowed this to be done. She used to say that it was more important to produce work than to disseminate it, and that her collaborators could disseminate her work after her death. In 1903, the Institute initiated a large project including an exhibition, a book, and a documentary. This work toured in Brazil and abroad. At this point, I was invited to be part of the team who embarked in this adventure. I call this an adventure because Lina's oeuvre is very broad. It includes architecture, of course, but also writings, set designs, jewelry, furniture, exhibitions, posters. Lina was a multifaceted artist. To select and to edit her work was a big challenge. I took charge of selecting the texts for the book and for the exhibition, and to write the script for the documentary. Lina's works and thoughts were, until then, virtually unknown. Our task was to show them in their intense beauty, both poetic and politic. Other books came after that, and other exhibitions. Lina was finally recognized as one of the greatest architects of the 20th century, and others will continue to appear. Lina's work is unique, and it remains incredibly up to date. It's not by chance that people in Brazil and the world are mesmerized with the grandeur, the beauty, and the originality of this constellation called Lina Bo Bardi, a constellation made of multi-stars. Sorry.
First, I would like to thank you, to thank the for this organization, Ana and the AA for this invitation, and the support for the Brazilian Embassy. So we're going to read this text for the first introduction. While still an architectural student at the University of São Paulo, I saw a lecture with the architect Lina Bo Bardi. Even though I had chosen the MASP, São Paulo Art Museum, one of the city's icons projected by her at the 60s, as a model for a drawing course I had attended in school, I have never heard of Lina at the faculty. I found this incredible, as this happened in 1989 in São Paulo. I felt bored and unmotivated, and her talk, in which she presented a project that was designed in Salvador, Bahia, made a real impact on me. At the moment, it became clear that architecture could be both liberating and committed to a cultural agenda. I also realized that the practical of an architect should be consistent and stretch beyond the realm of formal speculation. Right after that, I approached Marcelo Ferraz, who was organizing an exhibition about Lina's work in the school. With great generosity and openness, Marcelo responded to my wish to join their team, offering me first an internship in his office, Brasil Arquitetura, and then to join the team of Lina's office, which had then also Marcelo Suzuki and André Weiner as collaborators. It was a life-changing experience. We worked in the small studio, close to the glass house, this little hut you see in the picture, which was the type of hut used by her as office at the building site. There we developed models, drawings, and presentations. I was lucky enough to work with the team at the restoration of the building that would house the new town hall in São Paulo. By the time, however, Lina was already ill, and she was hardly present in the building site. After Lina passed away in 1902, and with the creation of the Bardi Institute, I helped to organize major retrospective of Lina Bo Bardi's work, which toured to the world from 1903 to 2001. Through the Institute, I also worked on other books that aimed to disseminate the work of other important Brazilian architects, such as Artigas, Heidi, and Lele. I currently work in the field of the exhibition design and communication and as technical director of Museu da Casa Brasileira, which is a museum of Brazilian home. And now we work in a public museum, we are the only public museum in Brazil devoted to architecture and design. And recently we have been working intensively on the projects that aim to attract a wide-eyed audience beyond the specialists. Those include musical concerts, urban events, architectural tours, included guided bicycle tours and places architectural interest in the city of São Paulo. So, Lina and material culture. Almost the vast amount of material that one can draw from Lina's work, I'm particularly interested in how she addresses the human habitat and its connection to material culture. In Italy, Lina's experience as Gio Ponti collaborator is crucial in this regard, as Ponti was, in his own right, a keen researcher on material culture. Lina joined his practical right after she graduated crossing to live in modern Milan rather than in conservative Rome. Unlike other Italian architects, Ponti wasn't a fully aligned to the rationalism and the fascist architectural tendencies at the time. He loved Italian craftsmanship, meticulous and intricate from architecture to applied arts, and he understood the decorative realm as a rich source of cultural values. There was in Italy at that time a search of simplicity, a taste of spontaneous architectural manifestations, primitive shelters like the ones found, for example, in the house built by the rural population. Italian modernists searched for a way to marry historical traditions and national identity. It's true that it was also in this context that the nationalist fascist tendencies were developed. Gio Ponti was engaged in the dissemination of the rationalism in Italy, together with Eduardo Persico, who ran the magazine Casabella. They strived to create a genealogy to modern architecture, heavily based on the primitive hut and also on architectural writings. Between 1941 and 43, Lina shared an office with the architect Carlo Pagani. She illustrated journals and magazines and worked in the publication Lo Stile, founded by Gio Ponti. She collaborated in popular magazines such as Tempo, Grazia, and Vetrina, where she disseminated design and architecture to a non-specialized audience. Also, she directed the Domus magazine during the German occupation, together with Melchiorre Bega and Carlo Pagani. During the war, those were difficult times. The experience of the Second World War had a major impact on Lina Bo Bardi. She participated in the resistance and faced the difficulties of living on the edge of surviving conditions with a very scarce material means, as she writes. In the wartime, 1 year corresponds to 50 years, and the judgment of men is a judgment for future generations. Among the bombs and the machine guns, I took stock of the situation and decided that the important thing was to survive, preferably unscathed, but how? I felt that the only way was the objectivity and rationality, an extremely difficult way to take when the majority of people opt for literary and nostalgic. Disappointment, I felt that the world could still be saved and for the better, and that this was the only task worth living for, the starting point to be able to survive. I joined the resistance, the clandestine communist party. I saw the world around me only as an immediate reality and not as an abstract literary exercise. Towards the end of the war, Lina wrote an article about the area that have been bombed. She devoted herself to the task of awakening collective consciousness addressing the theme of the reconstruction. This was May 1945, when she was working for the newspaper Milano Sera by Elio Vittorini. This is the time of this picture. Right after that, in 46, together with Bruno Zevi and other collaborators, she started the magazine A, Cultura della Vita, edited in Milan by the same editor of Domus. When writing for A magazine, Lina addressed the problems of post-war war in Italy. The precariousness of life in a world of scarcity and destruction. The first edition defined A for inhabitation, abitazioni, anxiety, love, amore, skill, abilità, audaciousness, warning, avvedimento, association and absurdity. We need to start from a letter A to plan a better life for all. We propose awake in each man and each woman the awareness of the home is and the city. Make everyone aware of the problems of reconstruction so that everyone and not only specialists take part in it. From an anthropological perspective, the magazine assessed the everyday problems of time, such as, for instance, the risk of the minefields, the threat of the atomic bomb, the modernization of home and family planning. This was a unique publication made by architects where architecture was not the end, but the means to understand and transform life. When Lina arrived in Brazil in 1947, she published a radical article criticizing the theatrical connotation of the 19th century European home. As she wrote, "When the bombs mercilessly demolished our homes, we understood that the house should be tailored for man's life. It should serve him and reassure him. It shouldn't display theatrically the useless vanities of the human soul. One can sense here a clear ethical position against excess, both physical and symbolic. This search for essential is sourced from the modern rationalism, but also from the history, which considers architecture a long-lived form of human expression based on the notion of the essential shelter. This also applies to objects, which, according to Lina, should result from a combination of technical knowledge and material availability." In Brazil, when Lina Bo Bardi launched the magazine Habitat in Brazil in 1950, she took inspiration from the previous work at the A magazine, particularly the research on autochthonous cultural manifestations. She researched vernacular constructions in Brazil, fishermen huts, wattle and dub houses, etc., and focused on the conservation and preservation of historical monuments. She wrote articles about Brazilian material culture, indigenous and African, describing tools, amulets, pottery, boats, etc. Her approach was a reaction against the general taste of the Brazil elite, generally interested in so-called high culture, a culture imported from abroad. By that time, Lina had already designed the first project for the Museum of Art of São Paulo in 1947, a refurbishment of an existing building. For this project, she developed a series of bespoke furniture as part of a laboratory she initiated together with the designer Giancarlo Palanti at the Studio Palma. The Studio Palma was devised to foster the Brazilian manufacture. The tripé chair is a rewriting of the traditional Brazilian hammock designed by Lina, was a typical outcome of this laboratory. In Bahia, some years later, around 58, she would discover the true creativity of the country as she described herself, alluding to the period she spent in Bahia. In this encounter with the deep Brazil, Lina mapped out the rich inventiveness of Brazilian people. She found in Bahia the opportunity to redefine an understanding of Brazilian material culture in a moment where this country was starting its process of industrialization. Lina tried to define a path of consolidating Brazilian cultural identity as a combination of the intellectual and the popular. Her attentive eye selected popular artifacts, defined by her as precraft, which showed a simple and creative approach to human making to create an archive of the Brazilian modes of making. His aim was to combine this autochthonous production with the growing industrialization of the country. As she wrote, "The Northeast has a marvelous handcraft tradition. all their objects, the working tools for the fishermen in San Francisco River, this reality is not less important than the context in which Alvar Aalto flourished or the Japanese traditions. Lina was a pioneer in placing contemporary popular objects regarded by her as modern in a museum context. The first time she did this was 1959 at the exhibition Bahia no Ibirapuera in São Paulo. This initiative was followed by two even bolder proposals for showing popular art in permanent collections in Salvador, namely at the Morner Art Museum and at the Popular Art Museum of Bahia. Lina was bold enough to celebrate the creative energy of Brazilian people, collecting objects as cultural evidence, showing the diversity of influence and providing an anthropological interpretation for our hybrid identity. She made a true inventory composed of intricate objects, most made by recycled materials, a valorization of simplicity, and not poverty, as she used to say. This hardly surprising that she did not get the support of the authorities. One of her exhibitions, Civilização Nordeste, scheduled to be displayed at the Galleria Nazionale d'Arte Moderna in Rome, was unexpectedly cancelled. It was 1964, and the Brazilian military government found it to be subversive. As Bruno Zevi wrote in the Roman newspaper L'Expresso, "The art of the poor scared the generals." She wrote, "The inventory of Brazilian precraft should have happened before the country was overtaken by global capitalism, when a democratic bourgeois revolution was still possible. The cultural opportunities of design could have been very different in this case, responding to the real needs of the country, as in a places such as Japan, China, and Finland, for instance." After that, she produced this chair, this cadeira beira da estrada, after the experience in Bahia, from 1967, maybe regarded in this light as a manifesto. It makes a case against the design. It was a turning point in Lina's career. From then on, we noticed that Lina's furniture started to be more closely linked to her architecture. It was conceived and designed for the spaces in which it would be used. The idea of furniture as a unique design product that strives for technical and aesthetic excellence ceased to exist in Lina's repertoire. Example of this new approach can be found in the furniture used in Sesc Pompeia, the Frei Egidio chair conceived for the Gregório de Matos Theater, and the giraffe chair made for the Benin House in Bahia. These chairs are shown in the exhibition next door. Lina kept producing furniture, but she became skeptical about the design industry. She said, "Art is not innocent. Our attempt to make design a driving force for the revolution of society failed. It was transformed instead in the bluntest evidence of the perversity of the system. A blind belief in endless progress had won the battle." Lina's unique trajectory, her understanding of the intrinsic value of the human objects, of their potential to contribute to the construction of a better life, conscientious of local demands, useful and not harmful to the environment, is a very important issue in the world we live today. We have an urgent need to responsibly transform the way we produce and we consume objects, given the alarming prospects faced by our current civilization. Lina's experience might provide a useful way out for us in this and other regards. Thank you.
I have to say, also to say congratulations to Ana and Catalina for the touching and delicate exhibition, Lina and Gio, The Last Humanist. It is really... And I think it's very appropriate to talk about humanism now, after the economic crisis and more. this is a good moment to talk about Lina's work and life. After this crisis, the last years, which had a big impact in the architecture that has been practiced by the star system, the same absurd and nonsense projects everywhere. In any country or culture, we could find the same acrobatic architecture. So, to come back to Lina's work, it is a kind of good way out, or better than way out. It is a kind of key, a good way to take again something like architecture on tracks. Why I'm saying this? Because the real and profound meaning and sense of architecture is to serve, to be useful, and for many people, from the house to communities and big cities. Those are important fundamentals, architectural fundamentals. And I think you agree with me. We are living times of pure appearance. Architecture as a show and not for the people. This is the importance to rescue the humanist side, to have courage to bring this very old term to the contemporary debate. But let's go to Lina's work. I will take some points about the Lina's that I suppose will help you to understand her work and why I'm doing this speech against so many important people. First, it is important to know that Lina came to Brazil after the Second World War with her husband Pietro Maria Bardi and had, both of them, the strong decision to adopt the Brazilian citizenship, and around it, they became Brazilians more than many of us because they had a choice. They leave the Italian citizenship to be Brazilians. She arrived in Brazil and quickly, almost immediately, found out the way to develop a very genuine and original work reported or related to the strength of Brazilian culture, something that she could see as a foreign eye better than Brazilians. But I think this was part of her character and formation, an anthropologist architect. She spent all her life trying to forget Italy or Italian European culture to enter deep in American culture. She came from the extreme rationalism to a kind of surrealism. I mean, to somewhere she had absolutely everything to do, to build, so to serve a lot. Have a great dedication to build worlds, the America. The reality mixed with dream, technical and poetic architecture functions at the same time as unity. I will show some images about. I will start with. You can go from it. Yeah. This is the Ponti's drawing. I will try to show how Lina started or arrived in Brazil as a very, very influenced by Ponti, but very European, very rationalist, and by the time transformed herself or tried to transform herself into a very Brazilian, adopting Brazilian shapes and forms and materials. Let's go. This is the Lina's drawings that you have in the big book. Very close to Ponti, you can see. You will see many, many drawings by Lina, very, very close. It was really her professor. Let's go. This is also very rationalist, some images. Next. This is one of the first Lina's projects by Lina in São Paulo, the site of the big newspaper that was not built. This is one drawing very close to the Lina's house. You can see the shape. You can see Ponti again. This is the glass house. I used to say this is a female Miss. It's very Miss van der Hoe, but this female touch. That's the house, inside the house. This is the project that for the museum close to the sea, in São Vicente, close to São Paulo, was maybe the precursor of the art, the MASP, the Modern Art Museum, the Art of São Paulo. This is the museum, the very famous MASP in São Paulo. And here you can see, after seeing the Ponti and the some images from Giancarlo, you can see she liberated the paintings from the walls. This is very American. Lina used it to say, this was possible in America. You could not do a museum like this in Italy, because you have to organize by schools of paintings, by I don't know, times. And in Brazil, there is a big family. You have Van Gogh close to Giotto, a big dialogue where you can discover and you can do your choice, your connections. This is very good. This is the glass easel, very famous. If you go there, you will not see this glass easel because they banned it to the museum. This is we are fighting for a long time to take again this kind of supports to the Pinacoteca, but it's very difficult because they have this very complex mind, or they have to copy European solutions. So they have labyrinths and walls and this kind of museum, very, very normal. Okay, let's go. This is a house close to Lina's house. This is the Valeria Sihel's house. You can see this is after Lina visited Gaudí in 1957. The house, the project is 59, more or less, but with very Brazilian elements she discovered that we need some protection from the rain. We need to enclose the plants and all, everything. Go again, the house. It is a beautiful house. This is the Solar do União, the complex in Bahia, in Salvador. A beautiful place. If you go there now, every Saturday you have beautiful parties. They use this place now for to a museum. Modern Art Museum? Yeah. Yes, Modern Art Museum. But was at that time it was projected to be a popular art museum. It's not very appropriate to a modern art museum, but it's okay. The very famous staircase. It's really, really a very modern element with wood, made by wood, in an old building. This is a kind of dialogue, very strong dialogue of elements. This staircase again. You have beautiful pictures from this project here. This is the a small church in Minas Gerais, Uberlândia, in which you can see the Italian, again, the Lina's drawings. You can see Ponti, you can see this kind of liberty in proposed, and the church, very little bit Roman on top. This is another church, a small one, close to São Paulo. Very Brazilian, very, again, next. This is Sesc Pompeia, the leisure center in São Paulo. An old industry. This is the new buildings, in dialogue with the old buildings in bricks. This is our beach, We used to say São Paulo, we don't have the sea, so we have the summertime, we have people there using it as a beach. It's very expressive. This is a kind of metropolis by Fritz Lang. Okay, next one. You don't have windows, you have holes. Again, next. This is the theater in the, that complex, Sesc Pompeia. The both side, Plateia. You can see the balconies. It's very inspired in a theater, the Elizabethan, Elizabethan theater. You can see the galleries to have people very close to the stage. Next. This is the same place. Again, next. This is the central road in that place, in Sesc Pompeia. Next. And this is in Bahia, in Salvador, a restaurant with a big mango tree in the middle, now abandoned for many, many years. We try to rescue, to use again, but it's there. Things about Brazil, but this is another text. Okay, knock talk. So, yes. This was a kind of contamination process. She let herself free for it and forced it to do it, to it. The second point is the work on site. Lina always tried to have her studio on site together with the work, going every day, developing the drawings, following the experiments to be built, going beyond the single project, taking design as a mission. Architecture is built work. And for this, all efforts are valid. She used to say, drawings are not enough to build, to express a project. The three dimensions and materiality you have only at sight. Yes. This is Lina working in 1960 in Salvador, in that complex, Solar do Unhão. Lina is there in the back. Yeah. Next. Here Lina, during in the MASP, in the São Paulo Art Museum, with this mechanism of press-stressed, I don't know, the press-stressed mechanism of the slabs. Lina trying, testing the support, the glass easel, with this very well-known painting, collegial, this guy.
But that was the original.
Yes, yeah. Yes, it was there, yes. At that time, it was possible. You don't need the courier, no. This kind of protection, secure insurance. Now it's everything forbidden. The world is very poor now.
Yeah.
This was 67, because the museum was opened in 1968. Okay, this is Lina in that church in Uberlândia with the collaborators. I'm here in this.
Yeah,
when I had hair. This. And here in Sesc Pompeia, we had many, many places, many offices, or many studios in the site. Lina, André Weiner, the engineer, and me. Okay. So we had our studio in different spaces at Sesc Pompeia. During 9 years, we moved from one to another space, following the evolution of work, taking a very close and strong contact with the technicians, engineers of structure, hydraulic, etc., etc., and workers. Simple people that were involved to bring their contribution in many situations, giving opinion and showing their abilities. Lina was a maestra in discover the talents. Many workers had their extra value expressed in a final image of the work, like the visual communications of the complex, some wood sculptures handmade by them, some finishing solutions, etc. Going to the third point, very close to the second, and related to it, it is the approach she had to conceptualize the program. Lina subverted the previous program she had received as a commission from the clients. She took the program not as a simple list of spaces to receive uses and activities. She understood program, or conceived program, as something absolutely new that can happen in the future space. In the future space, people actions, new behaviors, space for welcome unknown. There is a phrase by Gilberto Gil that I like very much. This is the name of a song that says something like, people know what they want, but people want also what they don't know. This is very good to explain how Lina worked. Lina tried to offer solutions to these written wishes that lies everywhere in any single person or community. I will give to you an example of Sex Pompeia. Looking around from the people that was using the space of the old industrial buildings in the beginning, children, old people, young people playing football, families parties, to the intellectual and sophisticated thinking she had in mind, she subverted the program completely. She changed the name of the center from cultural and esportivo, cultural and esportivo in Portuguese, to a leisure center, a place for conviviality. And not only the name, within this act, there was a new concept. We don't need to say this is cultural. Make and produce culture is everywhere. Streets, squares, bars. We need meetings of people gathering in comfort. With sports was the same. People can enjoy, have pleasure in many kinds of sports without the idea of competition. So, culture as obligation and sports competition in that center were banished. This was the decision by Lina, by the architect, not by the client. This was incredible. How can the architect put himself in the middle of these programs? In that atmosphere, Lina was creating a new ambience, a new reality, a new objectivity to provide good conditions to people live together in the free time in everyday life. Life as a goal. Architecture as a gun. This is the fourth point. Architecture as a gun. Architecture as a tool or a weapon to transform realities and societies. As daughter of modern movement, Lina had this very visible side. She believed on it, and I think we architects have to. This is the essence, the core of architecture. Her bases were to take the place, o lugar, or the locus, as protagonist. Try to get all you need for your project from the place, not only material, but spiritual. Rich or poor, the locus, geographic and historic, space and time, the human locus, can give us the solutions we are looking for. To practice architecture as prospection and projection at the same time as unity was the Lina's method of doing it. When you are drawing, writing, or taking photos, anyway, you are selecting points, you are choosing, you are proposing by your selection. To project is to see in the future something that doesn't exist yet. But this thing can be full of references that fulfill our lives. And poetry is one of our needs that can be useful, a fundament to produce the best architecture for the people. And Lina passed through this way, a difficult and wonderful way. If you ask me what I heritage from Lina, I would say we were talking about this question this afternoon. Is what I have from Lina with me is the indignation and passion in doing architecture. I think two very strong and good elements to use architecture as a gun. This is all. Thanks.